सुना ठीक है।
थैंक यू सो मच विश्वेश भाई। नाउ आई आई रिक्वेस्ट श्री ध्रुवेन साहब, पास्ट प्रेसिडेंट ऑफ इनकम टैक्स बार एसोसिएशन, टू गिव ब्रीफ बायोडाटा ऑफ आवर ऑनरेबल डिग्नेटरी श्री अमित जैन सर, एंड रिक्वेस्ट हिम टू गिव हिज काइंड स्पीच। ध्रुवेन भाई
साहेब नो परिचय आपको एक खूब ज मुश्किल छे, परंतु एमनी ओळख एमना कार्यो छे, गुजरात साथे एमनो खूब गर्व रह्यो छे। एवो डायरेक्टर जनरल ऑफ इन्वेस्टिगेशन तरीके जयरे गुजरात में सेवा आपी हती अने अत्यारे पण सेवा आपी रह्या छे, साथे साथे प्रिंसिपल चीफ कमिश्नर ऑफ गुजरात नी तरीके पण तेओए सेवा आपी रह्या छे। मित्रों खूब सरल अने साजिद जेम धीरजभाई साहेबे कीधुं के अमारी प्रथम मुलाकात नी अंदर एमनो प्रोएक्टिव एप्रोच टेक्स पेयर अने टेक्स प्रोफेशनल माटे एक साजिक रजूआत हती के टेक्स पेयर चार्टर अने फेसलेस मां पड़ती पारावार मुश्किलीओ बाबते खूब साजिक रीते एमने सामेथी कीधुं के मुश्किलीओ सरळ करे मुश्किलीओ नुं सोल्यूशन लावा माटे हुं गुजरातमां अहींया बेठो छुं, तमारा प्रश्नो लावो, तमारा जेटला प्रश्नो हशे એ બધા પ્રશ્નોનું નિરાકરણ કરવાનું છે। ગુજરાતની ગૌરવ ગાથા એ સમગ્ર દેશમાં નોંધપાત્ર રહી છે, આપણે શું જાણીએ છીએ। એ ઇન્કમ ટેક્સ હોય કે વિકાસની બાબત હોય, ટેકનોલોજીની બાબત હોય, તો એ ગુજરાત હંમેશા અગ્રેસર રહ્યું છે। આ ગુજરાતના ભગીરથ કાર્યોની અંદર દીર્ઘદ્રષ્ટા એવા શ્રી અમિત જૈન સાહેબ આજે ચાર્જ સંભાળ્યો છે, તો તેમના નેતૃત્વ હેઠળ ગુજરાતનો કર વ્યવસાયી અને કરદાતા કેવું સફળ રીતે કોમ્પ્લાયન્સ કરે, ઇઝ ઓફ કોમ્પ્લાયન્સ થાય, તેમજ સરળતાપૂર્વક કોઈ પણ પ્રશ્નોનું નિરાકરણ થાય તેમનો ખૂબ અભિગમ એવો રહ્યો છે। તેવા શ્રી અમિત જૈન સરને ખૂબ સરળતા આપણા એડ્રો ફેડરેશન માટે પણ ખૂબ લાગણી છે, ફેડરેશન તેમજ ઇન્કમ ટેક્સ બાર એસોસિએશનના આમંત્રણને માન આપી અને ફેસલેસ ને પડતી મુશ્કેલીઓ, ઈ પ્રોસીડિંગને લગતી મુશ્કેલીઓ, ઈ અપીલને લગતી મુશ્કેલીઓ માટે આપણા એસોસિએશનના પ્લેટફોર્મથી પ્રશ્નો આવકાર્યા છે। તો આવા સરળ અને સાહજિક શ્રી અમિત જૈન સાહેબનો અત્રે ઓલ ગુજરાત ફેડરેશન તેમજ ઇન્કમ ટેક્સ બાર એસોસિએશન અને તમામ એસોસિએશન વતી અંતઃકરણપૂર્વક આભાર વ્યક્ત કરીને આવકારું છું અને આ તબક્કે શ્રી અમિત જૈન સાહેબને સંબંધિત પ્રવચન આપવા માટે, સંબોધન કરવા માટે આમંત્રિત કરું છું। શ્રી જૈન સાહેબ
am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So once again, congratulations to you on launching of this IT Mirror. Now, as you all know, that the government is preparing its in the history of independent India in tax administration. And on 13th of August, as you know, our Honorable Prime Minister has inaugurated the platform of transparent taxation, honoring the honest. And you all know that it consists of three limbs. One is the faceless assessment. Then the second is the faceless appeal, which is going to be introduced on 25th of September. And the third and the most important, and probably also for the first time, is the taxpayer's charter. Now, this taxpayer's charter is also very unique. So let me first start with the faceless assessment scheme. And you all must have got the idea as to what this scheme is. But briefly, I would like to state that this is totally on the digital platform. And everything with respect to the scrutiny assessment is concerned will be done on a faceless manner and will be done by a separate unit, which is known as the faceless assessment units. So, and in all over India, these units have been established. We have already passed the orders, and some of the orders will be diverting the post to this new, these units will be passed and will be fully functional from 1st of September. Now, this assessment scheme we'll be discussing maybe at a later occasion as to what are the processes and how it is going to be done. But basically, it is on the basis of randomized allocation of assessment scrutiny assessments to various assessment units, and these units will be randomly selected on the basis of algorithm by the National E-Assessment Center, and the selection of cases also will be based on the risk parameters, and it will be ensured that cases which are, say, suppose of Ahmedabad, they are not allocated to the Ahmedabad assessment units. They will be going to some other unit in India, and so on and so forth. So this scheme is basically to avoid the physical interface between the taxpayer and the department. The taxpayer can submit its submissions online, and they will be examined, and there won't be any requirement for visiting the offices and things like that. So as you can see, that this is basically to bring the confidence between the taxpayer and the department, and this kind of transparent taxation is actually the requirements of the 21st century. It is a platform, one of the biggest tax reforms in the tax administration since independence, and it has not been introduced anywhere in the world, not to say of India. So we are very hopeful that it would provide the basic framework of tax administration in India, especially with respect to the scrutiny. Now, the other aspects like collection, recovery of taxes, and other judicial functions will be taken over by the territorial jurisdictions, which will be carved out after forming this. So that will also be done simultaneously, and the territorial other miscellaneous works will use technology, and will also ensure continuity through the COVID pandemic through digital nature of its processes, as I said. So this is regarding the faceless assessment scheme. Now I would also like to tell you about and highlight about the taxpayer's charter. And this taxpayer's charter is different from the citizen's charter, which we had come across in the earlier years. This taxpayer charter has 14 points for the department, where the department commits to the taxpayers certain services, and taxpayer also is expected to perform certain functions and is expected to commit to the department and to themselves six types of commitments. So the most, let us come to the commitments made by the income tax department towards the taxpayers. So there are 14, but I would highlight some five points which are very important. One is that the department from now onwards will change its attitude and will treat the taxpayers as honest. This is one of the very, very important commitment which we are going to make towards the taxpayers, and we'll provide fair, courteous, and reasonable treatment to all of them, which were not there, although we had been advocating this. But this taxpayer charter is now a legal document as far as the commitment is concerned, and every tax officer has to adhere to it. Now, then the third most important is to respect the privacy of the taxpayer. The department commits to respect the privacy of the taxpayer, then maintain confidentiality. And also very, very important is to enable representatives of choice. So there is no question as to the departmental officer enforcing upon the SSE to choose which tax advocate or not. There were a lot of complaints which used to come earlier that why this, why not this chartered accountant or tax advocate, and so on and so forth. So these are five very, very important commitments which the department has made towards taxpayers. Others are provide mechanism for appeal and review, complete and accurate information to the taxpayer, timely decisions, collect correct amount of taxes, hold its authorities accountable. Very, very important. And provide mechanism to lodge complaint. So we have already done that in the form of CPGRAMS and also through one window system, which we are following in Gujarat. And also Gujarat was one of the first in India to do this. Provide fair and just system, publish service standards and report periodically. So this is also a very important onus on the department and to reduce the cost of compliance. Now, with respect to the taxpayers, the three, as far as my this thing goes, is that a very important aspect which has been mentioned, which relates to taxpayers, is know what representative does on his behalf. So now the taxpayer cannot say that I didn't know whatever has been done is done by my tax advocate or chartered accountant. So now the taxpayer has to commit to the department that they should also get involved in the tax matters. They should respond in time. This is also one of the commitment, because most of the time either emails are not open, or now since everything will be communicated digitally and through emails, so it is very, very important that emails are open regularly and seen, and the response should be given in time. Because if the SSCs don't respond in time, then e-verification cannot be done. And if suppose e-verification goes flat, then there will be a red flag which will be marked in the computer system, and the number of red flags may decide whether the case has to come in the scrutiny or not. And unnecessarily, if the taxpayer doesn't respond, the case may come in the scrutiny, and the taxpayer will have to go through the hassle of submitting explanations and submissions and documents and things like that. So very, very important is to respond in time. Then another commitment is to pay in time. So if the taxpayer is committing to pay in time, and today's topic of yours is collection and recovery, I think, then if you are committing to pay in time, then you cannot, the department of being harsh in collection of. So be honest and compliant. The taxpayer has to be informed, and the taxpayer has to keep accurate records. So I think this is one of the most important aspect of the faceless assessment scheme, the transparent taxation, which the government has introduced for the first time. And I hope my tax professionals and tax chartered accountants and tax advocate would definitely educate the taxpayers, would cooperate with the department and them to respond in time. Thank you very much. I think this will give you a brief idea of the scheme. More such webinars can be done later on, where we can show you the details on various issues. You can send your responses, you can send your queries to us through your association, and definitely each and every suggestion or your queries will be attended to. That is my promise. And wherever we feel that we have to go to the government, then we'll be referring those matters to the CBDT for clarification, or maybe some FAQs with respect to those queries. Thank you very much. I hope you will be benefited with this webinar, and my good wishes to all of you. And congratulations once again in bringing out your IT mirror mouthpiece of the IT Bar Association. Thank you very much.
Very, very well said, sir. Thank you so much for your for your excellent speech, sir. We assure you that if the department is committing so much to the taxpayer, and when the talk of commitment is there, then we all tax professionals are not lagging behind, and we are committed to the income tax department that we will do our work, our job, with efficiency, transparency, and honesty. And sir, you can trust all the tax professionals, and you can anytime communicate to all the professional association for any of the your message. If you want to convey to the taxpayers, we will do our best to spread the message of income tax department of the government to the taxpayers to make them literate. So we assure you, sir, that we will work hand in hand with income tax department. Once again, sir, we are obliged that you have given your precious time for unveiling of IT Mirror and for this webinar, sir. We thank you from the bottom of our heart. We all seven professional association, all the dignitaries, we thank you so much for your gracious presence. Now I request.
Thank you.
Now we are heading. Thank you, sir. Now I request Sri Mrudang Bhai Vakil to give the biodata of our today's expert faculty, Sri Parth Bhai Contractor. Mrudang Bhai.
Thank you. President of IT Bar Association, Mr. Ashutosh Bhai. President of AGFTC, Sri Bharat Bhai. President Emeritus of IT Bar Association, Sri Dhiresh Bhai. And eminent advocate, Mr. Parth Contractor. Friends, I consider to be a great pleasure with pride to introduce this gentleman to this August gathering. Before I elaborate his milky biodata, let me share to this audience that Parth had successfully argued the income tax writ petition in the year 2014-15, pursuant to which the tax audit date and the income tax return filing dates were synchronized for the cause of AGFTC and taxpayers at large. So he is amongst us. Mr. Parth Contractor is a qualified chartered accountant and information technology engineer, a combination of commerce and science which a human being rarely possesses. But he is a shining as a counsel doing litigations across various tribunals and courts all over the Indian jurisdiction. His specialization and focus is on the tax laws, economic offenses, civil disputes, company matters, and arbitration. A versatile character, specialization in multifarious field. Mr. Parth is shining in the galaxy of leading advocates and has been a part of some of the most important and law-defining disputes. May I take the opportunity to mention here. Number one, Sinofi case of the taxability of indirect transfer of shares, Oracle custom disputes, inquiries of money laundering faced by a certain business houses, several high profile company law disputes, so on and so forth. Mr. Contractor has been a part of the team which advised and successfully defended the clients at various forums, including the Supreme Court of India. The forum and field of Mr. Parth is largest telecom operators, pharmaceutical major, largest denim and garment manufacturer, largest ice cream manufacturer, construction companies, etc. Mr. Parth is enjoying highest level of his capabilities. Sky is the limit for this gem of a person. He is amongst the person who make things happen. He is not in the habit to watch things happen. Over and above the profession of advocacy at a tender age, Mr. Parth is also rendering his services in advisory capacity in as many as 11 places. People like Parth are few and far between. People like Parth are thanked for so many reasons and appreciated beyond the words. His contribution to focus on various journals is also outstanding, which includes BNA Asia Pacific edition, BNA Indirect Tax edition, the Indian Business Law Journal, and the Economic Times. He is also a member of the International Fiscal Association. I would like to end with this saying that people who shine from within don't need the spotlight, and Mr. Parth who shines from within. I introduce before this gathering Mr. Parth Janakbhai Contractor as a champion of all the champions. Thanks to one and all.
Thank you, Mrudang Bhai. Excellent introduction, and we are very much sure that as the introduction is interesting, the lecture will be more interesting. So without wasting much of our time, Parth Bhai, the platform is yours. I request all the panelists to please switch off your videos for the better clarity, and the platform is yours, Parth bhai.
Thank you, Karthikey bhai. Thank you to Ashutosh bhai. Very happy birthday to him. Thank you, Bharat bhai, Dheeresh bhai Shah, and all other office bearers of all the associations for inviting me here and for giving me this opportunity to discuss this issue of stay and recovery of demand. In as much as Mrudang bhai said, shining light, light nu to mane khabar nathi, but atyar na shining etla mate chhe because there's too much light on my face. So on that lighter note, let me just do a screen share and we can run through the PPT thereafter. Is the PPT, can you see the PPT?
Yes, sir. Proper.
So to begin with, we are all aware about the various assessments that are there, the various types of assessments. We have under 143.1, what we call a summary assessment without calling the assessee. We have under 143.3, what we call the scrutiny assessments, which now effectively have gone into e-assessments. We also have best judgment assessments under section 144, which also now form a part of the e-assessment. We also have assessments under 147, which are the income escaping assessments. And then we have the block assessments under 153A and 153C. The reason of understanding these assessments is that a culmination of either of the assessments eventually is into either the proceedings being dropped or there being no demand against the assessee, or there being a notice of demand being issued against the assessee under section 156 of the Income Tax Act. We typically get a notice of demand under section 156 calling upon the assessee to pay a certain amount of demand within the stipulated time period. The demand under section 156, section 221 provides that such a demand has to be paid within the 30 days of the service of such notice. A 30-day period is a statutory period. The department may very well choose to provide you with a period lesser than 30 days, subject to the same being approved by the Joint Commissioner. What happens upon the expiry of this 30-day period, if the 30-day period expires and you have not paid the requisite demand, then you will be treated as an assessee in default, and proceedings for recovery of the tax demand will be initiated against the assessee. There is a provision whereby an option upon an application is given whereby the concerned assessing officer may extend the time period for the payment of the demand or may allow installments, subject to obviously the conditions that he may impose. So therefore, another question also comes up is that in the event you fail to make payment within this extended period, or if you default in making payments, whether you will be treated as an assessee in default. The answer to this is that in the event of you completely failing to pay the demand, you will be treated as an assessee in default. If you fail to pay an installment in time, but you subsequently pay the amount in the subsequent installment along with the earlier installment, there is a possibility that you will be looked at with some sympathy and it will not be treated as an assessee in default. So therefore, the most important aspect is to ensure that if there is a demand, that demand is paid within the stipulated time, unless otherwise stayed by way of a specific order passed under section 220 subsection 6 of the Income Tax Act. Now, what does 220 subsection 6 read? It is important that I read the provision so that we have a better understanding. 220 subsection 6 reads as under: where an assessee has presented an appeal under section 246 or section 246 capital A, the assessing officer may, in his discretion and subject to such conditions as he may think fit to impose in the circumstances of the case, treat the assessee as not being in default in respect of the amount in dispute in the appeal, even though the time for payment has expired, as long as such appeal remains undisposed of. Now, the reason to read this and understand this importantly is that one, after there is a notice of demand, while you prefer an appeal, you will have to make an application seeking a stay before the very assessing officer who has passed the assessment order. The assessing officer is at the discretion whether to stay or not stay. So there is it. You need to understand that if an application is filed, mere filing of an application does not mean that the demand is stayed. There it will have to be an order passed whereby the assessing officer accepts your stay application subject to certain conditions which he may impose. If the demand is stayed, then for the period of the demand being stayed, the assessee is not treated as an assessee in default. Now, therefore, going forward, if stay nathi malto or malelo stay vacate thai jaye che, then in such a case, you will be treated as a assessee in default and your consequences for recovery will follow. Away, just stay of demand and the entire situation which has arisen, there is a history to it. And to better understand how the whole the whole issue has evolved, the whole law on this issue has evolved, it is better that we see this entire thing right from its inception. So therefore, on 21st of August 1969, CBDT issued one instruction number 96, where it is stated that if the assessed income is substantially more than the returned income, so therefore, tamari returned income 100 rupiyani je, pursuant to the assessment proceedings, the returned income by the assessing officer is say 200 rupees, then it is therefore twice your returned income and therefore it is to be treated as a substantially higher. A collection therefore in such a case in view of circular CBDT instruction 96 will therefore have to be kept in abeyance until the time the appeal is decided. So therefore what happens, the reason is that this circular CBDT 96 may not be prevalent as on date, but it gives us some idea of what a substantially high demand is. Because in case of high pitched assessments, now what is a high pitched assessment is nowhere defined within the provisions of the Act. So therefore, a substantially high assessment or a high pitched assessment, you will have to consider on the basis of the law as it has evolved. Here 69, the notification says that if your returned income is, your assessed income is twice the returned income, the amount, the assessment will be treated as substantial. And therefore, we can say that wherever twice or thrice the amount, you may treat it as a high pitched assessment. Going forward, 93 ma there is a CBDT instruction 1914. This CBDT instruction is completely opposite to the CBDT instruction number 96. Now CBDT instruction number 96 said that jyaan tamari returned income karta assessed income double ke double thi vadhare hoy, त्यां तमारे demand नी recovery abeyance मा मुकवी. However, 1914 says, as a matter of principle, every demand should be recovered as soon as it becomes due. So therefore, the whole concept of keeping the demand in abeyance in case of a high-pitched assessment, etc., basically was done away with this introduction of CBDT instruction number 1914. 1914 was introduced in 1993. There has been no subsequent, as far as I understand, subject to correction, there have been no subsequent interim notifications or instructions in this regard. So therefore, 1914 continued to prevail. In the meantime, Taneja Developers versus ACIT, 324 ITR 247, making a reference to instruction number 96, it said that the assessed income was more than 350 times the returned income, which was unreasonably high pitched, and in such a case, the recovery was paid. So therefore, looking at the facts of that case, where the returned income, the assessment income was almost 350 times more, the High Court, Delhi High Court, stayed the recovery against the assessee. At the very same time, subsequently, in December 2009, the CBDT issued a clarification. Now, this clarification specified and it reiterated that the instruction number 96 was superseded by the instruction number 1914. Therefore, the magnitude of the addition to the income returned would not be the sole determinative factor, meaning thereby tamari assessed income returned income karta ketli vadhare che is not a determinative factor whether to grant a stay or not to grant a stay, or whether to keep the recovery in abeyance or not. Therefore, when this clarification came in December 2009, which is after the judgment of the Honorable Delhi High Court in February 2009, whether this clarification was in the face or in the teeth of or directly contrary to the decision of the Delhi High Court, in my humble submission, yes. So therefore, the reason being, an instruction or a clarification or a circular issued by the CBDT, we all of us are aware, is binding on the assessing officer. It is not binding on the assessee. Now, when there is a judgment of a high court, the judgment of the high court will obviously have far more binding, will be binding not only on the assessing officer, but will also be binding on the assessee. So therefore, according to me, there was no reason why the department should have issued such a clarification. And CBDT instruction number 1914 should have been read with the judgment of the Honorable Delhi High Court issued in 2009. And accordingly, the stay of applications should have been decided. Be as it may, 2015, CBDT issued an instruction number 17. Now, this is important because by this instruction number 17, your high-pitched assessment committees, which are either you name it as the high-pitched assessment committees or you name it as local committees, these came into existence. Now, the language of the notification is important, and therefore I will read only what is relevant. It says, it has however been brought to the notice of the board that the tendency to frame high-pitched and unreasonable assessment orders is still persisting, due to which grievances are being raised by the taxpayers. Such grievances not only reflect the harassment, but also lead to generation of unproductive work for the department as well as for appellate authorities. the purpose of constituting the local committees is to be effectively and efficiently deal with genuine grievances of taxpayers. So therefore, to address your genuine grievances of unreasonable and high-pitched assessment orders, this high-pitched assessment committee or the local committees came into being. Now, what is the constitution of the local committee and what is the local committee required to do? I will deal with it in the subsequent slides. Proceeding with the chronology of the of the circulars and the instructions, after the constitution of the high-pitched assessment committees, a modification came into instruction number 1914 in 2016 by way of an office memorandum, wherein it was stated that during the pendency of an appeal before the CIT appeals, the assessing officer could grant a stay on the demand till the disposal of the appeal. This is important because sometimes there is a confusion ke bhai aaj tumne stay grant karyo che on the demand, it is till what time period, whether till the matter is finally determined, whether the matter is finally, whether the appeal is finally heard, meaning whether the High Court appeal or the Supreme Court appeal? No. The instruction here says till the disposal of the appeal, the disposal of the appeal before the CIT appeals. Now, this memorandum introduced that if there is a payment of 15% of the disputed demand, then there is an automatic stay till the disposal of the appeal by the CIT appeals. So therefore, a benchmark of 15% was introduced. The 15% is on the disputed demand. It is not on the, generally, there is a misconception. Sometimes, erroneously, the assessee goes ahead and says that 15% is required to be paid on the demand plus tax, which is raised. Please understand, this is only on the disputed demand, tax demand, not on the interest amount. So therefore, what was required to be paid was 15% of such disputed demand. Most importantly, it needs to be noted ke aa 15% a internal guideline, internal benchmark che. This 15% is not introduced by way of an amendment in the act. So therefore, it is not strictly statutory. This modification also gave the discretion to the assessing officer to increase or to decrease this amount of this 15% subject to the approval of the principal CIT or the CIT. This assumes importance because on many occasions we encounter that once this such a percentage in demand has been notified or has been provided, the assessing officer tends to go by this on the fact that he is bound by a instruction or a notification, and therefore without any further deliberation or evaluation, straight away tamari disputed demand na 15% bharvano order karvama aave, however good the case of the assessee is. So therefore, there is a scope whereby you must insist on the merits of your case, establish that you have a prima facie case, and thereby impress upon the assessing officer that 15% is not required, that I have a case whereby demand must be stayed completely without making any payment of pre-deposit. For that, if he needs to refer and seek an approval of the commissioner or the principal commissioner, so be it. You must make an application or a request for him to do so. In the event you prefer an application for a stay and the assessing officer passes an order which you are not happy with or which you are aggrieved by, then in such a case, you have the option of seeking a review of such an order by the principal CIT or the concerned CIT. So therefore, one more stage, assessing officer tamaru stay application per order kare. If you are happy with that order, well and good. If you are not happy with that order, you have the option of approaching the higher authority and seeking a review of such an order and seeking either a reduction on the stay of demand in the percentage or seeking a stay of demand without a pre-deposit. Further modification was introduced to this instruction 1914, whereby, as we said, the 15% benchmark was raised to 20%. So therefore, with effect from 31st of July 2017, the benchmark is that if your disputed demand is 100 rupees, then you make an application to the concerned assessing officer. He, upon you making a payment of 20%, that is 20 rupees, will pass an order staying the demand up to the time the CIT appeal disposes the appeal. Now, what happens is this, it is important to note, today this 20% is in force. So therefore, aaje te tame proceedings karo cho, ema, therefore this, you are required to deposit 20%. One thing important, which I would suggest you keep in mind, is that assessment order ni same appeal karvathi stay automatically mali jato nathi. So what you need to do is, along with preferring an appeal before the concerned appellate authority, parallelly you have to mandatorily, if you want a stay, prefer a separate application under 220 subsection 6 before the concerned assessing officer and make a specific prayer for the grant of stay. Now, in terms of this instruction, which was modified in July 2017, if you show your willingness and if you make a payment of 20% of the disputed demand, the grant of stay, according to me, will be automatic. However, if you want to make out a case for a stay, for a pre-deposit which is lesser than 20%, or for a waiver of pre-deposit, you will, in such a case, you will have to make out a case, one, on prima facie, that you have a case on merits, and obviously, two, you will have to show and demonstrate financial hardships. One thing is slightly anomaly. There is a slight anomaly in this modification, because it says that in the board's efforts to contain overpitched assessments through several measures resulting in fairer and more reasonable assessments, the standard rate of 15% is revised to 20%. Now, if there have been fairer and more reasonable assessment orders, and if the board's efforts have been to be fair, then the question of raising the demand from 15% to 20% should not have arisen, first. Secondly, this itself, according to me, runs slightly contrary to the internal communication. On the 4th of July 2018, the then CBDT chairman had issued a communication to all the principal CITs where he had expressed his displeasure at the inaction of the high-pitched assessment committees. And in this communication, the CBDT chairman had also raised a concern that unreasonable and overpitched assessments were being made. And therefore, this whole reason of raising the 15% to 20% on the ground of the fair and reasonable assessment orders, I don't seem was a plausible reason. However, today, as the law stands, 20% is the internal benchmark set by the department for obtaining a stay of demand. before we go to what you must put in a stay application, how you must draft a stay application, what strategy you must adopt, what constitutes a high-pitched assessment committee, what is a high-pitched assessment, etc. એ બધું જોતા પહેલા there are certain judgments on this issue which are landmark judgments which will set the tone of everything that we discuss going forward and will be very important whenever you want to prefer a stay application before the concerned authority. The first judgment is Ashok Bhai Jagubhai Kheni, 405 ITR 179. In this case, considering the facts of the case, the Gujarat High Court reduced this 15% to 7.5% on the ground that the additions made by the assessing officer were arguable. So therefore, this is important to the extent that if you are able to show that on XYZ grounds, the additions made by the assessing officer are not sustainable, or that there is a chance that such additions may be dropped going forward, or they are not in accordance with settled law, then you therefore go one step ahead by showing that there is a prima facie case in your favor, seeking a blanket stay on the demand raised against the assessee. આમાં 67% કર્યા હતા. ઇફ યુ આર એબલ ટુ કન્વિન્સ ધી કોર્ટ ઓર ઇફ યુ આર એબલ ટુ કન્વિન્સ ધ કન્સર્ન અથોરિટી ફોર અ કમ્પ્લીટ વેવર, દેર ઇઝ નથિંગ ઇન લો વિચ પ્રિવેન્ટ સચ એન અથોરિટી ફ્રોમ નોટ ગ્રાન્ટિંગ અ વેવર ઓન પ્રી ડિપોઝિટ. ધ સેકન્ડ જજમેન્ટ ઇઝ થંગરાઈ શ્રી વિદ્યા મંદિર ટ્રસ્ટ, 263 ટેક્સમેન 42. In this case, the Madras High Court proceeded further, wherein the assessing officer had taken this 20% of the disputed demand. Madras High Court effectively came to a conclusion that the order passed by the assessing officer was liable to be set aside for various reasons. Therefore, the demand prima facie was not sustainable, and therefore the assessing officer was directed to remit the 20% of the tax demand and allow the stay application. So the whole order whereby he said that you please pay 20% so that I can allow the stay application, that the Madras High Court said was liable to be set aside, and therefore if you are able to establish a case on merits, the waiver of pre-deposit can be granted. Thereafter, we have a case of Dalpat Singh Vasava, 226 Taxman 125. The requirement of depositing a disputed tax due here was reduced to 10% from 20%. And the High Court held that the tax demand was very high and the issues were at a first appellate stage. Even 20% of the disputed demand would run into lakhs of rupees. So therefore, if you are able to show financial hardship, if you are able to show a prima facie case, you can get a reduction in the 20%, bring it down to 10%, as we saw earlier, to 7.5%, or even to a complete waiver of pre-deposit. Supreme Court in the judgment of LG Electronics delivered in July 2018 has very categorically said that in the facts of an individual case, so therefore the officer has to look at each case individually, the officer is empowered to grant a deposit of an amount lesser than 20%. So therefore, once again, a 20% a benchmark nathi. In most of the cases, when we file stay applications, we go on an assumption ke sahib 20% bhari dida mate stay mali gayo. I would request that we make that effort we go that one step further and to make that effort to say that 20% barabar che 20% par to mane malvano ch stay but why should I not make that effort and ensure that lesser than 20% deposit is obtained, or we try for a complete waiver depending obviously on how good or bad your case is, and make that effort before the assessing officer to ensure that you get some relief in terms of the pre-deposit before for your assessee. Two very important judgments. This is Kannamal versus ITO, and the next judgment is Flipkart. Kannamal is by Madras High Court and Flipkart is by the Karnataka High Court. These are very important judgments because they set the tone in terms of what are the guiding principles for grant of stay. And paragraph 12, which is very important, I would just like to read it slowly for your convenience. The circulars and instructions as extracted above are in the nature of guidelines issued to assist the assessing authorities in the matter of grant of stay. They cannot substitute or override the basic tenets to be followed in the consideration and disposal of stay petitions. Existence of a prima facie case for which some illustrations have been provided in the circulars themselves, the financial stringency faced by the assessee, and the balance of convenience in the matter constitute the trinity. So basically three tenets: prima facie case, financial stringency, and the balance of convenience, so to say, are indispensable in consideration of a stay petition by the authority. So therefore the authority will have to consider whether you have a prima facie case, whether you have a financial difficulty, and whether you have a balance of convenience in your favor while deciding the stay application. The board has, while stating generally that the assessee shall be called upon to remit 20% of the disputed demand, granted ample discretion to the authority to either increase or decrease the quantum demanded based on three vital factors to be taken into consideration. So therefore the Madras High Court has very clearly said ki bhai aa 20% ek gospel truth nahi. This 20% is only an internal guideline or a benchmark ki bhai 20% bhare to apvana j. There is no requirement whereby he can say ki bhai tame 20% bharo cho ne hu nahi apu. But if you are able to demonstrate a prima facie case, a balance of convenience in your favor, and a financial difficulty, or that equity exists in your favor, then the concerned officer will have to take these into consideration and take a decision whether to reduce the pre-deposit from 20% to a certain percentage, or possibly, if convinced, to waive such pre-deposit. Generally koi waive kartu nahi, because they would insist that they are bound by this 20% guideline. The second important judgment is in the case of Flipkart India. This is a judgment delivered sometime in the year 2017 by the Karnataka High Court. This is also very important because it deals with the whole 2016 circular and the subsequent modifications that came to be issued, and the 1914 that we saw earlier. So I would want to read this paragraph also for your benefit. It is true that instruction number 4B of the circular dated 29-2016 gives two instances where less than 15% can be asked. Now please understand, this 15% is a reference because the 2016 circular referred to 15%, which was subsequently modified to 20% in 2017. Less than 15% can be asked to be deposited. However, it is equally true that the factors which were directed to be kept in mind both by the assessing officer and by the higher superior authority contained in instruction number so and so of the circular 1914 still continue to exist. For as noted above, the said part of circular 1914 has been left untouched by the circular dated 29-2-2016. So 1914 was in 2015. 29-2-2016 came subsequently, which was further modified in 2017, whereby the 15% was raised to 20%. Therefore, while dealing with an application filed by an assessee, both the assessing officer and the principal CIT are required to see if the assessee's case would fall under the instruction so and so of the circular 1914 or not. Both the assessing officer and the principal CIT are required to examine whether the assessment is unreasonably high pitched or whether the demand for depositing 15% of the disputed demand amount would lead to a genuine hardship being caused to the assessee or not. So therefore, this also reiterates the same thing. 20% therefore is not sacrosanct. You can make out a case for deposit of an amount lesser than 20% of the disputed amount, or also try and make out a case for a complete waiver of pre-deposit for the stay of demand. So coming to the question, looking at these case laws and a reading of these circulars, whether this pre-deposit of 20% is mandatory, the answer in my humble submission is no. The office memorandums and instructions are all internal guidelines of the department. They do not bind the assessee, neither do they bind the court. Obviously, they will have some persuasive value, but these are not binding. It only binds the assessing officer to the extent of setting a benchmark. Now, that assessing officer, if I read all of this together, cannot refuse to grant a stay once you agree to make this deposit of 20%. But if you are able to demonstrate a case whereby a waiver can be made, given, or whereby a lesser pre-deposit can be made, then that has to be considered by the assessing officer by passing a detailed speaking order. So therefore, the demand of making demand to make a 20% pre-deposit is not a matter of right for the department. It is only a suggested benchmark, and it does not take away the right of the assessee to apply for a waiver or a reduction in pre-deposit, which application will have to be dealt with by a speaking order. So therefore, now what options do you have? 156 no order pass thayo. Tame. Therefore, what are the further steps or the further course of action? The moment an order under 156 is passed, within the 30 days period, one, obviously, you will have to move an appeal, challenge that order, and move before the concerned appellate authority. Parallelly, you will also have to prefer an application under 220 subsection 6 and prefer an application for stay before the concerned assessing officer within this 30-day period. Obtain a stay from this assessing officer on the basis of the grounds that you make out. If you are aggrieved by the order passed by such assessing officer, you will have the option of taking it further before the concerned higher authority or the CIT, requesting for a stay on the basis of the merits of your case. If the CIT or such higher authority does not consider your application, or you are aggrieved by such order passed by such officer, then the available remedy is to approach the jurisdictional high court. If you are based out of Gujarat, then the Honorable Gujarat High Court, and make out a case for a reduction or a waiver in the pre-deposit. Importantly, we will see later that by way of a judgment of the Supreme Court, the CIT appeal, and by way of an amendment in the subsequently by way of an amendment in the Act, the Income Tax Appellate Tribunal, both have the power to grant a stay on the demand during appellate proceedings. So therefore, while 220 subsection 6 says you the regular required mode of getting a stay is by making an application under 220 subsection 6. However, as per what the Supreme Court says, the appellate authority also has the inherent power to stay the order which is under challenge, thereby staying the demand. However, we very rarely see such powers being exercised by the appellate authority. Now, what are the factors that you need to keep into consideration while seeking a reduction or a waiver in the pre-deposit? When you make an application, tame jare application banao cho, tyare please keep in mind to make out a case in the application to show that one, that the demand itself is unsustainable in law. So therefore, challenge the order, rather demolish, try and demolish the order on merits to show that this is not maintainable. The demand per se is unsustainable in view of the various judicial precedents as well as in view of the law as it stands today. Two, therefore, you will try and establish a prima facie case. Please import note that for a stay or stay which is in the nature of an interim relief till the demand, till the appeal is pending, what you need to show is not a foolproof or a watertight case. What is required to be shown is that you have a prima facie case. Prima facie jota tamari favor ma jo arguable case tamari favor no lage, balance of convenience tamari favor ma che, then the assessing officer is required to grant a stay on the demand. Additionally, you also need to establish for the purposes of balance of convenience and equity that if such a stay is not granted, what loss, harm or injury will be caused to the assessee. In this, you will obviously have to include the ground of financial hardship. Atyarna time ma, this assumes importance because in the COVID times, for various reasons, liquidity is blocked. Making any payment in terms of tax demands will eventually lead to a reduction or a blocking of liquidity, will cause further hardship. Therefore, if there is a sympathetic view which the department can take, you must make an application for the same. I am sure the department will consider, especially in these times, and take a sympathetic view and grant you whatever best possible order that that can be granted. Assuming you make this application, you make out an excellent case on merits for prima facie and on the grounds of irreparable loss, harm and injury, and the officer does not grant a stay of demand, what happens? Very well, you still have the option, as we discussed, to challenge it further before the concerned higher authority, being the CIT. Even if the CIT does not consider, then you have the option of challenging it in a writ proceeding before the High Court. If you have the foundation ready, if your foundation is strong, if your pleadings are strong, if you have made out a good case at the very beginning stage, then if it is rejected, it will give you a foundation to make out a case whether before the CIT or before the High Court. So therefore, making out a strong, robust case for a stay is extremely, extremely important. So therefore, as we discussed, you can obviously prefer an application to the CIT for reconsideration on the stay of demand. And if they don't grant you any relief, or if you're aggrieved by the order passed, you can obviously approach the High Court under Article 226 of the Constitution of India. As we discussed, that the appellate authority also has the power inherent to stay the demand. Now, this has been laid down by the decision of the Supreme Court in the case of ITO versus Mohammad Kunhi, 71 ITR 815, where it says that the CIT appeals is empowered to stay the demand during the pendency of the appeal before him. So on the same principle, even the ITAT would be empowered to stay the demand or to stay the order while hearing the appeal. However, we have very rarely seen these authorities exercising these powers. Now, there is a twist. From 1/4/2020, 1st April 2020, 254 subsection 2 capital A has been amended, and the amendment is important because it empowers the ITAT to pass an order of stay in any proceedings relating to an appeal filed before it for a period not exceeding 180 days subject to 20% pre-deposit or furnishing equivalent security. The hearing of the appeal has to be concluded within this 180 days period or maximum 365 days. If this 365 days ma appeal conclude nathi thati, the stay automatically gets vacated. Please note, there is no provision granting any power to the ITAT to extend such stay from beyond this 365 day period. So therefore, the onus is on the assessee and his representative to ensure that his matter pending before the ITAT, where the stay has been granted exercising powers under 254(2)(a), is heard. Is heard and concluded within this 365-day period. Otherwise, your stay will stand vacated, and if you don't pay up that demand, despite the pendency of the appeal, you will be treated as an assessee in default. However, in this, what is important to note is this 20% pre-deposit requirement has been introduced by way of an amendment in the statute, and it empowers the tribunal to grant this subject to 20%. So this is as per law. However, I still feel that in the event there are circumstances whereby the appeal cannot be heard because of no fault of the assessee, then given the powers that the authority has, I think there is some Ruben Bhai, can we mute the participants, please? So therefore, you will have to ensure that, make out a case before the ITAT that even after this 365 day period, because of this XYZ situation which are not attributable to the assessee, the stay must continue, and the exercising its inherent powers and exercising in view of the judgment of Mohammed can continue with the stay which was granted earlier. We all face this issue in terms of reasonable demands are and high-pitched demands are raised. The unreasonable and high-pitched demands, according to me, a possibility is that even the department officers are saddled with recovery targets. Their appraisals are based on the recovery and on the demands. So therefore, there is bound to be a case, instances where more and more demands which are high pitched are raised. However, we heard today the principal CCD say that the concerned department, in view of the taxpayer's charter, is going to ensure that they will be treating all of us assessees as honest assessees. And most importantly, officers will be held accountable for the orders that they pass. So therefore, this is important, because if an unreasonable and unjustified order is passed, which eventually leads to a high-pitched demand, and that order is vulnerable or is subsequently set aside, then that will reflect on that assessing officer's performance. He will be held accountable. And therefore, we hope that in view of this, the whole unreasonableness and unjustifiable demands will at some stage will reduce or will come to an end. And therefore, hopefully, there will be more balanced and merit-based demands. What one needs to also consider is that what happens where a patently meritless high-pitched demand is raised, and any other, he does not consider facts and merits. He raises a demand in which the assessing officer ultimately is likely to succeed. But he raises a demand where otherwise the assessee is not liable to pay any tax, but he raises a tax of say 100 rupees and the assessee is required to pay 20 rupees because of such a high pitched demand. He has to wait for years to have his appeal succeed in appeal, and thereafter wait to get a refund claim, and therefore block the liquidity and obviously suffer in terms of the commercial activities or the business that he does. So we hope and pray that this whole new introduction of the taxpayer's charter, as well as with the new introduction of the e-assessment procedures, which has a lot of internal checks and balances and internal review mechanisms, unreasonable and unjustifiable orders will not be passed, and there will be merit-based orders which will be passed. So now coming to high-pitched assessments, we saw that by way of instruction 17 of 2015, local committees have been constituted. These local committees basically were expected to dispose of taxpayers' demands, rather grievances. What is this local committee required to do? The local committee is required to see whether the assessment order is frivolous in terms of the additions that have been made, whether the principles of natural justice have been followed, whether the assessing officer has properly and judiciously applied his mind, and whether there is no negligence on the part of the assessing officer. In case the demand is found to be unreasonable and high-pitched, or that it is found that the additions are frivolous, or natural justice is not followed, or there is non-application of mind, then this local committee, which is the high-pitched assessment committee, will recommend initiation of administrative action against such assessing officer. Please note that this is only for the purposes of such assessing, such a high-pitched assessment committee making a recommendation for initiation of administrative action. This is not in any manner a proceeding whereby your stay application or an order passed in a stay application can be reviewed. This is neither an alternative to an appeal. High-pitched assessments, the committee consists of principal CCIT. It is required to be constituted in each principal CCIT region. It has three members of a principal CIT or a CIT rank. And the committee, if necessary, can co-opt certain other members. The idea is that the high-pitched assessment committee has to dispose of these applications within 2 months. And importantly, if the high-pitched assessment committee comes to a conclusion that the assessment order passed is either unreasonable or unjustifiable, then such a position of the high-pitched assessment committee will or it should be placed before the concerned appellate authority, whether before the CIT appeals or before the ITAT, so that the whole litigation can be curtailed and such appellate authority can take a decision in view of the internal departmental position which the high-pitched assessment committee communicates. Now, what all can we do as far as the high-pitched assessment committee is concerned? Suppose a high-pitched order is passed and a high-pitched demand is raised, then one option obviously is to approach the high-pitched assessment committee, put out your grievance to say on these grounds as to why the demand is frivolous, why that principles of natural justice were not followed, or that it is not in accordance with law, and make out a case prima facie in your favor. Parallelly, it is not a substitute to an appeal. So therefore, parallelly, you must prefer an appeal also against such an assessment order within the stipulated time period. And three, also separately prefer an application under 220 subsection 6 seeking a stay on the demand. And in the application for stay on demand, raise a ground that you have also preferred an application to the HPAC. One, prefer an application then to the HPAC to expedite the hearing on the ground that the stay application is pending and any order passed by the HPAC will have some bearing on the order passed in the stay application. Obviously, in the stay application, HPAC matter apply kareli che that a ground sathe sathe, it is also important that you raise other grounds like prima facie case, balance of convenience, financial difficulties, etc. Please note that this HPAC is constituted through a CBDT circular. The CBDT instruction can change at any given point in time. So therefore, don't treat it to be sacrosanct. What is required in law is one, an appeal, and two, an application for a stay of demand. Before approaching the HPAC, there are certain things that you need to keep in mind. If the HPAC concludes the assessment is high pitched, then obviously it is good. You will have no coercive action for recovery of demand. In that case, thereafter, you can put up that order of the HPAC before the commissioner appeals and request the commissioner appeals to take into consideration such an order passed by the HPAC and expedite the hearing of the appeal. A favorable view will obviously benefit the assessee. It has a persuasive value, but it cannot bind the appellate authority. So therefore, you cannot say that the HPAC has said that this is an unjustifiable order and therefore the tribunal will be bound by it. No, the tribunal obviously will assess or consider or adjudicate upon the concerned order in accordance with law on the merits. It obviously, the order of the HPAC will help in giving a high persuasive value to the pending appellate proceedings. Now, what strategy you must adopt, whether to approach the HPAC, not approach the HPAC, to only file a stay application, to first file a stay application and then go to the HPAC or vice versa, etc. You will have to determine after considering your facts and your merits. Consider all the pros and cons. Ke bhai, HPAC na order ni impact stay application par su aavse, stay application ni impact HPAC par su aavse, HPAC na order ni impact tamari pending appeal ma su aavse. Consider all of that and then take a decision on strategy and thereafter proceed further. One important issue which has come up is that there is no interlink. Suppose, for example, there is e-assessment and now there are e-appeals which with effect from 25th of September 2020 will come into force. Now, in terms of the e-assessment, the assessment is concluded through the e-assessment proceedings and the papers and the entire file is sent back to the jurisdictional assessing officer for initiating further actions of recovery. It is at this stage that you can prefer an application under 220 subsection 6 to the concerned assessing officer. However, if the officer grants a stay, that stay is not reflected in some manner in your whole online system, which is now completely digitized, and there is a stay, there is a demand which continues to be shown against you, and subsequent yerma there is a refund which is required to be given to you, then because there is no that interlink between the time that a stay is granted, there is a possibility sometimes that happens is that your demand is set off against the refund ane pachi 20% demand no, it becomes, the whole process becomes infructuous. So there is that one small link that needs to be tied up in this whole e-assessment, e-appeal proceeding, which I'm sure that the department will do sooner than later. What happens if there is a failure to pay the installments? Obviously, it will lead to a default. In that default, if you are able to recoup the earlier default and set it off in subsequent defaults, and be defaults agal sathe bhari kado to ensure that eventual time period ma tamari demand bharai jaye, then I'm sure the department will take a sympathetic view and not treat it as a default. Otherwise, if you are not able to pay the amounts within the time period stipulated, unless otherwise condoned and the benefit granted to you, this will be treated as a default and obviously recovery options will follow. So therefore, to conclude, in these times of e-assessment and e-appeal proceedings, we had seen earlier, and all of us are also aware, that this whole e-assessment proceeding has a two-layer system whereby an assessment order is passed. It is subjected to a review by a separate review unit internally. The draft order is subjected to a review, and that draft order thereafter is converted into a final order after taking up a, giving you an opportunity of a final hearing, etc., personal hearing, etc. So therefore, because one, there is going to be internal checks and balance. Two, the order is going to be a subject matter of review. Three, because the assessing officer passing such an order is going to be held accountable for the orders that he passes, I am of the belief, and I would rather want to believe, that going forward we are, or we should be able to see more orders passed which are justifiable and which are passed on merits. Therefore, to conclude, please ensure going forward, stay applications, I see them also going into the entire e-assessment and e-appeal modules. So at some stage, all of this will also go into such a mechanism. So therefore, right from today, whenever you prefer an application for a stay, please ensure that your entire case is made out in detail. You set out all your facts. On the basis of those facts, you clearly set out what the position of law is. Put out your detailed submissions, including all judgments that you wish to rely upon. Ensure that your pleadings are complete, yet they are crisp. And therefore, you set a tone that even if your application was to be rejected or an order which was to be passed, which the assessees agree with, you still have a good footing to stand and to go forward before the concerned higher authority or before the High Court. So therefore, to conclude, we hope and wish that the this entire system of e-assessments and e-appeals and this whole faceless mechanism which has been evolved will benefit the assessee ultimately, and justified and reasonable orders will be passed. Thank you. Over to you, Karthikeya bhai. Asutosh bhai, I think you are not audible. Tamaru unmute karu pad.
Ji Parth bhai, thank you very much. હું અહીંયા આગળ બધા જે આપણા પેનલિસ્ટ છે તો એમને રિક્વેસ્ટ કરું છું કે જે આપણા વિડીયો છે અત્યારે સ્ટાર્ટ કરશે અને જે તમે અત્યારે લેક્ચર આપ્યું છે પાર્થ ભાઈ, એમ કહેવાય કે ભાઈ એમને બી મારો જન્મદિવસ છે, મને શીરો બહુ ભાવે છે, પણ તમે જે રીતનું ઉતાર્યું છે, પેલો શીરો ઉતરે ને ઘી વાળો, એમ લબ લબ ઉતરી ગયું છે એની અંદર. એમ આજનો જે આપણો આખો પ્રોગ્રામ રહ્યો બહુ સરસ રહ્યો, પણ એ પ્રોગ્રામમાં ચાર ચાંદ લગાડ્યા આપણા જૈન સાહેબે, અને એ જ રીતે કહેવાય કે ભાઈ મીન્સ કે છે ને અહીં તમને હું એક બી જગ્યાએ ન જ ભૂલી શકું પાર્થ ભાઈ. હું ઈચ્છું મીન્સ કે છે ને આપણા જે મારા જોઈન્ટ સેક્રેટરી છે અત્યારે ધ્રુવિન મહેતા, તો આગળનું વોટ ઓફ અત્યારના થેક્સની પ્રોસિજર કરશે. જી ધ્રુવિન ભાઈ.
થેન્ક યુ આશુતોષ ભાઈ. આશુતોષ ભાઈ, હેપી બર્થડે પહેલા, ફર્સ્ટ ઓફ ઓલ
થેન્ક યુ વેરી મચ ડિયર.
થેન્ક યુ. આઈ ઓન બિહાફ ઓફ AGFPCA એન્ડ ઓલ અધર જોઈન્ટ એસોસિએશન હિયર બાય થેન્ક્સ ટુ અવર પ્રિન્સિપલ CCIT ગુજરાત શ્રી અમિત જૈન સર ફોર દેર વેલ્યુએબલ ટાઈમ, એન્ડ ઓન બિહાફ ઓફ ઓલ ઓફ અસ એક્સટેન્ડ અ વેરી હાર્ટલી વોટ ઓફ થેન્ક્સ ટુ અવર એમિનન્ટ સ્પીકર શ્રી પાર્થ કોન્ટ્રાક્ટર ફોર શેરિંગ હિઝ નોલેજ વિથ અસ. આઈ ઓલ્સો વોન્ટ ટુ સે થેન્ક્સ ટુ ચેરમેન, co-chairmen and members of IT Mirror committee for this wonderful IT Mirror in this pandemic situation, and finally to all the wonderful participants who have turned up in such great numbers. Thank you so much for your cooperation. Once again I thank you all for your cordial cooperation. Thank you. Asutosh bhai.
Ji Parth bhai, thank you.
Thank you Asutosh bhai.
Thank you Dhruvin
bhai for having me here. Dhruvin
bhai. Okay Mr. je apne ahi agar શું કહે કે આજના પ્રોગ્રામને અત્યારના ક્લોઝ કરે છે અને આપણું જે આપણી છે ને મીટિંગ અત્યારે કન્ક્લુડ ડિક્લેર. થેન્ક યુ વેરી મચ.
અને ઇન કેસ ધેર આર એની ક્વેરીઝ, એનીબડી કેન ઈમેલ ઇટ ટુ યુ એન્ડ યુ કેન સેન્ડ ઇટ અક્રોસ ટુ મી. આઈ વિલ બી હેપી ટુ આન્સર ઓલ ઓફ ધોઝ.
શ્યોર પાર્થ ભાઈ. થેન્ક યુ સર.
થેન્ક યુ પાર્થ ભાઈ.
આવજો. થેન્ક યુ ફોર હેવિંગ મી.
Thank you.